Lord, I thank you that we have an opportunity to be here on this day, to hear your word and to let it grab a hold of us, but also to learn and to put something into practice that we're about to hear here today. God, I thank you for the veterans that we're honored here today, Lord, and I pray that you would continue to bless them and be with them, God. I thank you for the families who support them and have stood with them, whether times are good or bad, they've been there. Lord, I thank you that we've had a time to worship, we've had a time to praise your name. But now, Lord, I thank you that we have an opportunity to open our hearts and our minds and allow you to speak to our spirit. Lord, bless our time together. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. Now, if you want God to look on you with favor, it's really easy. It's really easy to get God's favor. I just read it to you. Be humble, have a contrite spirit, and tremble at the word of God. Tremble at the word of God. We live in a society where people no longer tremble at the word of God. There are people who scoff the word of God. There are people that don't believe the word of God. There are people that put coffee cups on the word of God. But we live in a society where the word of God is no longer what it used to be. How many of you have heard recent reports of courtrooms being people suing the city or the county or the state saying, you need to take down the Ten Commandments because we don't need that in this courtroom? I think that's interesting because in May, when I was in Senate, when I went to the Senate chambers, actually it was in the House of Congress, the one that you see when they do the State of the Union, and you have all the congressmen and the senators sitting on the left and on the right. In that room, there's a pictures like every 10 feet all the way around that room, and they have the greatest lawyers, the greatest law individuals, the greatest judges, the greatest philosophers of all time. But right dab in the middle, the speaker is standing here right there in the middle, across from him in that chamber where they do the presidential State of the Union address. Right across from him is the face of Moses. And it says Moses right there. They're taking the Ten Commandments out of courthouses all over the country. What are they going to do? Take Moses, who gave you the Ten Commandments, out of the most prestigious place? I doubt they're going to do that. There are people that don't believe the word of God anymore unless they want a favor from God. Now, there's many benefits to the favor of God. There's many things that can bless us. There's many things that can minister to our lives. In Esther chapter 7, verse 3, what does favor mean? It'll answer your petition. We just prayed this out about 2 months ago. Esther chapter 7, verse 3 says, then Esther the queen answered and said, if I have found favor in thy sight, O king, and if it pleases the king, let my life be given to me as a petition, and for that of my people I request. So Esther realized, if you have favor, you can get a request answered. We will receive life. Psalm chapter 30, verse 5, for his anger endureth but a moment. In his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. How many have experienced going to bed sad, going to bed mad, but God's favor had you get up with life and then there was joy? Amen. Our enemies will not triumph over us if we have God's favor. Psalm chapter 41, verse 11. In Psalm chapter 41, verse 11, the word of God says, by this I know that thou favorest me, because my enemies do not triumph over me. Now, I don't know about you, but those are all benefits that I want to experience in my life. I want to be able to have God's favor in my life, not the curses of this world. Probably one of the most important ones, the one I really want to lean on today, is Psalm 119, 58. Psalm 119, 58. This is what the word of God says. I entreated thy favor with my whole heart. Be merciful unto me according to thy word. So the psalmist David was saying, I am asking you with my whole heart. I have sought your face with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to your promise. The King James Version says, I entreated thy favor. I wanted favor on me. You want God's favor. What you're asking God for is mercy. And how many of us need mercy this morning? Say amen. How many are sitting next to somebody who needs mercy this morning? Say amen. Tell that person, may God give you favor and give you mercy. Jesus, the Bible says, grew in favor with God and man. We know that the Bible says of Mary, the mother of Jesus, she was highly favored by God. We know that Joseph was favored by the Pharaoh. He was favored by the prisoner, the prison captain. He was favored by his father. He was favored by Potiphar. We know that Joseph had favor. Gideon said to God in Judges 6:17, if I have seen favor, give me a sign that what you want me to do? David was highly favored by God above his brothers because he was the youngest, yet God favored him to be king. With all that can be said about the Lord's favor and those who in the Bible that we have seen have this favor, what does it mean to you and me? Now, this passage I'm going to read to you in Isaiah chapter 61. In Isaiah 61 is a passage that speaks about the Lord's favor. And it happens to be the passage that Jesus first read when he first started his ministry. So if Jesus thought it was important enough to say, I am going to open my ministry on earth with this passage, then it means this is a key passage in the Bible. Jesus could have picked any passage in all the Old Testament. He could have picked any passage, but he picked this one to start his ministry. Then you and I need to pay attention to why he picked it. Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1 and on. This is it. And when you hear it, you say, I remember when Jesus said this. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. Now, every one of us here has been anointed to do something. Everyone, if you know what your anointing is, say amen. Okay? If you know what your anointing is, tell the person next to you, if you know that person, my anointing is, tell them what it is right now. Okay? You tell them what it is. Don't just say, my anointing is. Tell them what you feel your anointing. I heard a bunch of people say, my anointing is. What is? What is your anointing? Now, Isaiah, and then later Jesus, would say, I am anointed to preach the word of God. But what's really important is whom they were anointed to preach the word of God. This passage says they were anointed to proclaim the good news to the poor. How many of you, everybody wants to be in the biggest church, they want to be in the pulpit, they want to be on TV, they want to be on Christian Temple 559 Facebook page, or ChristianTempleFresno.com, they want to be on that, they want to be in the Christmas play, they want to do all this, that, and the other. You know what? You don't got the right to sit in front of people to preach until you've preached the good news to the poor. Amen. Jesus began his ministry by saying, God has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. Isaiah is saying, God has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. Every one of us here, maybe you didn't have an answer when somebody, when I told you right now, tell somebody what your anointing is. Maybe you didn't know what to say. Maybe you were like, I have so many. Well, you have one for sure, and that's to preach the good news to the poor. Every one of us has been called by God to preach good news to the poor. Amen. Now, how many of you know there's poor people in Fresno? Say amen. How many know there's a lot of poor people in our church? Say amen. We are surrounded by poor people. So I mean, we should be spreading the good news all over the place. He said, you keep following the passage. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captive, and release from darkness the prisoners. Now, somebody would, what does it mean to bind up those who are brokenhearted? What it means this is, there are people whose hearts are broken. How many of you know somebody who's been through a broken heart situation? Say amen. How many of you are there? Somebody don't answer it. God has called us to preach to the poor, but he's also called us to speak to people who have a broken heart so that their hearts can be bound together again, so they can be brought back together to bind up the brokenhearted. I don't know if you thought that meant I'm supposed to go around fighting brokenhearted people and tie them up with ropes. No, that's not what it meant. What he was saying was, you are supposed to come and help that broken heart come together. Now let me tell you, you have no special skill or ability. You are not a trained counselor. You don't have this superpower of binding broken hearts. You do not. I don't know who you think you are, but you do not have the power to do it. But the word of God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, when you start to tell somebody Jesus loves you, Jesus cares about you, that person who's broken hearted begins to say, I know I'm somebody. It's the power of the Holy Spirit at work in their life, you know, holding them together like this. We're supposed to bind up the broken heart. We're supposed to proclaim freedom to the captive. I always thought, and I felt guilty, I'm going to be honest with you, I felt guilty because I thought that meant that I was supposed to be going to the jails and the prisons and speaking to the prisoners and the jailers. But that's not what this is talking about. Right under broken hearted, there are people that are held captive by sin. Because we never hear that Jesus, if Jesus said, this is what I was called to do, we would know that Jesus went to the jails and Jesus went to the prison. Jesus never went to the jails and Jesus never went to the prison. That was Peter and Paul. But they didn't go visit, they were there as guests. What we were taught by this passage might have been wrong growing up that you were supposed to go to jail or prison. No, you're supposed to go to the person that's held captive by sin. How many of us know somebody that doesn't want to do what they do, but they do it anyway? How many have met somebody who's been addicted to drugs or addicted to alcohol or addicted to this, that, and the other? You and I, by sharing the good news, will help them break free from whatever it is they're stuck in. Some people are prisoners because you won't preach to them. You're anointed to release those who are in darkness. Sin is dark, people. I see things out here outside my window and I just freak out sometimes. Sometimes I just close the blinds and like, I don't want to see what's happening. But God tells me, you need to go out there and tell that person that I love you. God, they're homeless, God. But what am I going to tell this person? They're going to ask me for a sandwich. And God's telling me, you need to share with them. You need to let them know that I love them and that I care about them. And I'm going to tell you something. Unless you're willing to do that to those who are brokenhearted, those who are held captive to sin, those that are in darkness, then you're not following what God has anointed you to do. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to get to heaven and God tell me, why didn't you do what I anointed you to do? How can you know somebody who's crazy? Say amen. Could they be crazy because of sin? Could they be in darkness because of sin? Verse 2 says, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn. Now, when Jesus read this passage, he got up, and the very first thing he did in the synagogue, he opened up the scrolls and he read this passage. Jesus stopped at to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. He read verse 1. And then he read to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. He did not get into the second coming of Christ. So what Jesus stood up and did, and we read at the beginning of his ministry, he said, I have come to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, and then he put it down. Now, what we believe as Christians and we believe as theologians and as study people is this. Jesus said, I'm here to usher in a new way of doing things. I'm here to usher in that you have God's favor. I'm here to say that the law has been completed in me, and you no longer have to go through all of that stuff. Now it's time of the Lord's favor. Now, I'm not a dispensationalist, but I believe this. In the Old Testament, they lived by the law. In the New Testament, and now we live by the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ. You and I were not saved by our acts of good, our good deeds. Nothing you and I did got us saved. The only thing that gets us saved is faith in Jesus Christ. So that means we're living in the era of mercy, in the era of grace, in the era of forgiveness that Jesus has provided for you and me. So you and I have a choice. Are we going to judge people and tell them everything they've done wrong? Or are we going to begin to tell people whatever you've done wrong is covered by the blood of Jesus if you're willing to accept his mercy and grace? In this season of mercy and grace, you and I have a responsibility to be proclaiming God's favor. Now, he said, I've come to usher in the time of God's favor. So you and I have been all these years in church asking God for something that he says, I've already given to you so that you can give it to the rest of the world. Let me say it again. When you watch the televangelists, they're preaching, proclaim it, name it, claim it, blab it, grab it, and you're supposed to be blessed and experience your positive moment and your positive aura and whatever karma you got coming, this and the other. They've been telling you to go after that which God has said, I've already given it to you. You're supposed to be giving it to everybody else. Everybody says, I want the Lord's favor. I hear them on TV. They're praying for something. They say, oh, I see God's favor all over you. You know what? If I saw God's favor all over you, it means you're preaching to the poor. It means you're going out to those who are brokenhearted, and you're giving them God's favor. God's not going to give you something you're going to keep to yourself. God's going to give you that favor so you can be him to somebody else. Some people don't have the Lord's favor because they keep it to themselves. Now, the second part of the passage, and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all those who mourn. Now, that's pointing towards the second day the second coming of Jesus Christ. That's why he didn't even mention it. He didn't even mention it because he knew he was going to have to die on the cross and come back. But he just told you and me, we're here. He says, I'm here to comfort those who mourn. How many of you are sad? Say amen. Some of you are sad. That's okay. There's a time to be happy, and there's a time to be sad. Well, guess what? After church, go to Daniel and he'll give you a big hug. Because he's here to comfort those who mourn. I would hug you, but it's not going to be big. Comfort those who mourn. Provide those, verse 3 says, and provide for those who grieve. In Zion, provide for those who grieve. You've been anointed with the favor of God to help somebody who's sad, to help somebody who's grieving, to help somebody who's going through a difficult time right now and is needing you to be God in their life. I believe the reason the church isn't making a difference with those who are mourning and those who are sad is because the church is filled with a bunch of people who themselves are walking around with a big sourpuss mug on their face. Now, if you're going through depression and you got a clinical thing, I take that back. Because I know there's chemical imbalances and things that could happen and things that are happening to you in your body that you can't control. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the people that are always walking around upset, angry about something somebody said or somebody did. Those people, we need them in church, because amen and hallelujah don't pay the bill. So we need them in church, but maybe we should start hugging them. If you see somebody here with a sour mug, I want you, Albert, if you see somebody and just, Albert, act like your man. Put on a really ugly skull, okay? All right, act like your man. Hey Albert, how's it going? I missed you, Albert. I'm so glad you're here. Okay? All right. Now, notice what I did. I'm bringing him in and close. I don't know if you know, a lot of people in church are like, what's up? When they're saying what's up, they're like keeping you out. Have you noticed that? Now, if you got a cold, that's acceptable. If you got the flu and you don't want to pass out, that's acceptable. But when they do this, it's like, I'm not going to let you in right here. Because when you do this, you're opening the hand and you're letting them in. They want to do that. So you got all these people sitting around, like, what's up? Now that's what they say, welcome, Brother Albert. I'm glad you're happy. I should pick a more sad person. But Albert, sometimes he's mad, all right? We need to turn those sour mugs. Thank you, Albert. Thank you. I should. He said he wore jeans in honor of Pastor, he said. He told me that before. I want you to understand something. You have been filled with the favor of God. And you said all at the beginning, I want God's favor. All you said, I want God's favor. I want them. You all said it. Well, you know what? If you have God's favor, you're going to be cheering people up who are sad. With an amen, hallelujah, praise the Lord. How you doing this morning? Some of you don't. When I see them say, I see God's favor all over you. I'm like, what are they doing that you see it? But sometimes I can see the chamuco all over them. Verse 3 says, to provide those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes. God has anointed you to help make people prettier. And there's a lot of ugly people for you to do that with. How many of you know an ugly person? Say amen. Just today, you saw an ugly person. Say amen. When you looked in the mirror, say amen. I'm not talking, the Bible says that we are all made in the image of God. So there's no ugly, physically ugly person. We're all a beautiful cornucopia. We're a big hodgepodge. We're a big salad. And we're all beautiful. All right. I want you to look at the ugliest person in here. Okay, why is everybody looking at me? There's no ugly with God. We're all beautiful in our own way. There are ugly attitudes. How many of you know ugly attitude people? Say amen. How many of you used to be an ugly attitude person? There's ugly attitudes, and the ugly attitudes don't honor God. God has called you to make those people beautiful. It says to turn beauty, to find beauty out of ashes. You're supposed to find beauty out of ashes, to bestow on them a crown of beauty. Now, I want you to picture this person sitting on a pile of ashes. They're mad, they're angry, and then they're sitting on a pile of ashes. This person sitting on the pile of ashes just grabs ashes and throws it at everybody that goes by. Just you walk by and they start throwing their ashes on you. And why are they doing that? Because they want you to have their ash. And they're just a bunch of ash throwers all over the place. Ashes over here, ashes over there, ashes everywhere. They're just throwing ashes at you. You need to not be an ash throwing person. You need to be a beauty throwing person. But you're only going to give what you're sitting on. And some of you have been sitting on your ashes too long. Yeah, that's going to go out on YouTube. You're only going to throw what you have. If you're sitting around moping, if you're sitting around all upset and angry, you're letting that all pile up around you, that's what you're going to give to others. Yesterday was such a nice, the last 3 days have been beautiful. I don't know if you noticed. The last 3 or 4 days have just been beautiful. I couldn't be in the house. It was too nice. And I just had to go outside. I had to be outside. And I was doing stuff. I was breaking things up. And I was fixing things. And I was doing things. My wife yesterday, my daughter's been outside for about an hour just working on the yard. And I was like, thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. They were outside. Let me tell you, you need to get out. Amen. Quit sitting on that big pile of nothing. Because that's all you're going to give people. Remember when you were young? I don't know if you remember. Some of you are older. I don't know if you remember when we were like in our young ages, we always say, are we going to go out this weekend? Did anybody ever say that besides me? Are we going to go out this weekend? Okay, just me and Charlie. Nobody else? The rest of you were like Sheldon from Big Bang Theory. You were a bunch of nerds. But me and Charlie, we used to say, are you going to go out? Are you going to go out? We used to always talk about going out and going out. Now, him and I grew up in church. Going out was to like McDonald's, the roller skating rink, bowling. Bowling was big. If you're a Christian, bowling was a big deal. Amen? Amen. See, some of you are like, I can come help you up. Yeah, this is a safe place. I was into roller skating. I was into bowling. It was just being out. You were happy. You were out. Some of you need to get out. Just get out. And you don't need money to get out. That's the problem is you believe you have to go spend money. You're not spreading beauty because you don't have beauty. Just get out, go somewhere. Go walk the mall and look at what all the people are buying. You're supposed to be turning ashes into beauty. Now, it's not walk up to a person and say, ding, you're beautiful. Compliment somebody. Hey, you look good today. Don't lie. Hey, you look okay today. Hey, you look better than last week. When I tell somebody, you know what? I'm just happy to see you. How hard is that? I'm just happy to see you. It's good to see you. I grew up in a culture where when you entered the room, you had to shake everybody's hand. And I remember as a little kid, and I would walk in a place, if I didn't do it, my parents would give me a coscorron. If you don't know what a coscorron is, just come up to the front. Daniel's giving hugs, I'm giving coscorrones. My mom and dad, some of you had a mom and dad that pinched, and maybe the pinch with the twist. I had coscorrones, bam! Go say hi to your tios. I'm like, I don't like my tios, but I get a coscorron every time I see them. How are you? It's nice to see you. Spread beauty instead of ashes. The oil of joy instead of mourning. And the garment of praise instead of the spirit of despair. We're supposed to be giving people joy. We're supposed to be helping those who mourn. We're supposed to help them. If we have the favor of God, it means we are the favor of God. I asked at the beginning, how many of you want the favor of God? Everybody said amen. You all said amen. You all said amen. Let me tell you something. Jesus ushered in the favor of God. It is a time of mercy and a time of grace. You should be going out of your way to forgive somebody today. Don't answer. But how many of you have been wrong? And right now, somebody has hurt you, or you're upset with somebody, or you feel that this person has wronged you? Well, I want to tell you this morning, the favor of God was given to you to forgive that person. You want to prove that person wrong. You want to show that person, you owe me an apology. This is what you did wrong to me. This is how you wronged me. This is what you did. I'm going to tell you, if you live life going through expecting people to apologize to you, that's just piling up that big hill of ashes that you're sitting on. Get rid of the ashes. Why? By forgiving them before the ashes even start piling up. I forgive them. They haven't even asked me for forgiveness, but I forgive them already. God, we love them. Pray for them. And that's why Jesus would say, pray for them to be blessed. Just pray for them. God bless them. It's not easy to do unless you have God's favor. I'm going to tell you something. You can't be a pastor if you have thin skin. The most criticized person in the church is the pastor. And rightly so. It should be the pastor. And in most churches, it's the pastor and the worship leader. So if you happen to be both, you're really getting it. You're really getting it. But I have learned to just in all things give thanks to the Lord. And just be full of joy. Does that mean I don't get mad? I get mad. I get mad, to be honest with you, I get mad. But it goes away quickly, faster than it used to. Why? Because I don't want to sit on a pile of ashes. And look at what happened. I close with this. If you do this, you will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for display and splendor. So, what God says, you're going to be called an oak of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. God says this, if you're going around encouraging people, if you're going around helping people become beautiful, if you're going around doing your part to help others be better, God is going to make you like an oak tree. Now, I want you to compare the oak tree to the palm tree. The palm tree is really skinny and long. It's pretty. But how much shade can a palm tree give? Not very much. An oak tree, on the other hand, would fill this facility. It would outgrow this room, and its branches would go wide within this building, and a whole city could go under and get shade. God is saying to you this morning, if you will begin to be a person filled with my favor, spreading it with others, I am going to raise you up like the most important tree. The strongest wood besides bamboo is oak. The benches are oak. Tables are oak, chairs are oak. Why? Because they're stronger, they're sturdier. And God is saying, I want to make you a strong, sturdy splendor of everything I have. God wants to lift you up and God wants to rise you up. He wants people to come to you and find shade. But if all you do is throw shade, he said in the next verse, you will recoil and you will renew. Verse 6 says, and you will be called priests of the Lord, and you will be named ministers of God. God wants you to be a minister of faith. God wants you to be a priest of faith. Now, when he said this to these people, those people in hearing Isaiah speak this, what do you mean we're going to be priests? It's impossible for us to be priests. We're not born Levites, we can't be priests. But remember what the New Testament said, for I have made you a royal priesthood. So before Jesus' time, this made no sense to them. But now after Jesus' time, you and I are a holy nation. You and I are a royal priesthood. You and I have an opportunity to be used by God. It's not just the pastor's job to be spreading a beauty, spreading joy. It's your job too. And I want to tell you, I'm going to give you this. God is anointing you this morning. To be his favorite. Are you willing to accept it? As Charlie Feinstein said,